Okay, so let us start with the lecture on kinetics. So what we take now, we saw as a derivation that for a rigid body, sum of all the forces is mass times the acceleration, and this result I have not derived. Okay, I have not derived this result, okay, but it is present in the slides, it is present in the textbook. So let us take this as a gospel that if g is the center of mass, then the rate of change of angular momentum, okay, of a rigid body about the center, okay, means for example that if we have a set of particles, okay, which are representing a rigid body, there are internal forces and there are external forces. This is external, this is external, this is external, this is external. Now for a rigid body, what we have is that we have g, which is the mass center, and with respect to g, any point I has a coordinate given by rho bar, whereas from a fixed frame of reference, g itself has a coordinate given by r bar. So what we can define is that, we can define that angular momentum of this system of particles about point g will be given as rho I bar cross mi rho I dot, okay. And you can do a simple derivation and show that dhg with respect to dt is equal to sum of all the moments due to external forces on this system of particles. And the same logic will be true because a rigid body can be thought of to be composed of, okay, a lot of particles, okay. So dh by dt can be shown to be equal to sigma m with respect to g. Similarly, if we want to find out what is the angular momentum with respect to O or this origin, then we can write this as ri bar, where ri, okay, is the position vector of point I, mi ri dot, and we can also show that dh0 by dt will be equal to sum of all the moments about point O. And then you can also show that dhg by dt is equal, dho by dt is equal to position vector of center of mass into m into acceleration of the center of mass, m is the total mass, plus dh0 by dt. So these are the results, okay, that we will use, okay, in our problem solving, okay. So keep that in mind. Now coming to this, now what do we have is that f bar is equal to ma, and with respect to the centroidal frame, okay, that centroid is really a special point, okay. What we can do is that we can have a look at the slides later on, okay, offline, and we'll realize that central is a very special point, and because of that, sum of moment about centroid is equal to h bar g. If this g can be replaced by a fixed point, okay, a fixed point, okay, which is not moving, then also this relation holds true. But if this point g is replaced by some other point p which has some kind of acceleration and motion in space, then this relation doesn't hold true. So always make sure that whenever these points are chosen for finding out moments or finding out what is the angular momentum and so on, choose it to be a fixed point, okay, or center of mass. Both of them are equally fine, but don't choose a moving point, and it will become clear as we proceed further with problem solving. Now these are the equations of motion of a rigid body, that sum of all the forces is equal to ma, where m is the total mass, a is the acceleration of the center of mass. This center of mass, sum of all the moments about center of mass is nothing but hg, which is the rate of change of angular momentum. Okay, what is hg? Is the angular momentum of all these particles about point O. Now, in a planar motion, coming to simple planar motion, what we can see is that, suppose we think about a motion, our total motion can be thought of as translation of center of mass plus rotation about a center of mass. What we had seen earlier, that any general motion of a rigid body, especially in 3D also, but especially in 2D, can be decomposed into translation of motion of one point and rotation about that point. So let us take that point to be the center of mass, and so the center of mass will keep moving, but the body also has some rotation, okay, around the center of mass. So now what we define is that the angular momentum around the center of mass will be given by, at any point, will be r bar, okay, ri bar. What is ri bar? Is the position vector of E with respect to r. Vi bar is the velocity, okay. What is this velocity? Is the velocity of this point relative to the center of mass, okay. It is relative to the center of mass, but what is that? That is nothing but omega cross ri. So we substitute that here and do an integral over all mass particles, and what we will see is that the angular momentum is nothing but this omega comes out, it is common for all of them, omega k, and the only thing that remains is r square omega comes out into delta m for all these particles. But what is this? Sum over all the particles r prime square delta m is nothing but I put an origin at this centroid, and at this centroid when I put the origin, this is nothing but the mass moment of inertia of the centroid. This, when this summation can be replaced by an integral, and this will become r square dm, and r square dm is nothing but the mass moment of inertia, okay, of this rigid body about which axis? About an axis in the z direction but passing through the centroid. Okay, so this is our hg, which is nothing but now I times omega. So that is a mystery why this I comes when we want to find out the angular momentum of a rigid body for rotation about its centroid. Okay, it is just I omega. Now after we differentiate, okay, this I remains constant, so hg dot, okay, will be nothing but I alpha. But we had seen earlier that what is hg dot? Hg dot is nothing but there are all these external forces acting on the body. Sum of moments of all the external forces acting on the body about point g is hg dot. So what we know, that sum of the moments of all the forces is nothing but I times alpha, where what is alpha? Alpha is the angular acceleration of this planar body for rotation about an axis along the z direction but passing through the centroid. Note that these results are also valid for not only for these thin slabs, but as I discussed earlier, that instead of this slab, I take a sphere, okay, and the sphere has a nice symmetry about a central plane, and the entire motion of the sphere, okay, happens along that plane, then also this is fine. Okay, so it is either fine for planar bodies or symmetric objects like sphere or cylinder, where you can cut through the center and all the motions subsequently are happening along the plane, okay, which is cutting through the center. Now coming to what is called as the D'Alembert's principle, what we had seen is this, that these are the forces acting on the rigid body. What is the effect? If G is the centroid, if G is the centroid, then what do these forces do? These forces will lead to an acceleration, okay, sum of all these forces vectorially is mass times the acceleration, okay, in some direction. What direction? Will be the direction of the resultant forces. What else? In addition, all these forces can also exert moment on this body about point O. In that case, the sum of the moments of all these forces about O is nothing but I alpha. What is this I alpha? If the moment is taken in the anticlockwise direction, then correspondingly the I alpha also is equivalent in the anticlockwise direction. So sigma fx is equal to max, sigma fy is equal to may, okay. What is this ax? Is the acceleration of the center of mass, m is the total mass, same for ay, and mg is what? Is the moment taken in either clockwise sense, in this case it is taken in the, sorry, in the anticlockwise sense, and alpha is the angular acceleration in the clockwise sense, okay. So these are equivalent. So what we think is this, okay, we can think about it in two different ways, that forces, acceleration, moments of these forces about point O, rotation, okay, I alpha, ma. Now we can do another thing. So what does D'Alembert principle tells us? That each of these small elements here, how do they respond to the forces that are applied? They respond by accelerating, okay, they respond by having some kind of angular acceleration about point G, and this effect of all these forces is essentially okay, is equivalent to the effective forces of the various particles forming the body. That each body point on the body has a contribution, and all those contributions will add to this. And how are those contributions created? They are created from this. Same goes for this, okay, that the external forces can create a torque about this, but because each and every point now, okay, has some angular acceleration, and that angular acceleration, okay, in terms of torque can add up about this point G, which is the centroid, and this is crudely speaking the D'Alembert principle. But mathematically speaking, what it means is that all the forces are acting, this is equivalent to this, that all these forces is equivalent to having mass times acceleration in a given direction, and some of the moments of all these forces about point G is equivalent, okay, to having, okay, I alpha, okay, in the same sense. But we can now do, what do is that we can bring it in this direction. What we say is that rather than doing this, we reverse the direction of this MA. Let us reverse it. If it is in this direction, let us say it is reversed like this, okay. This I alpha is acting in what direction? I alpha is acting in the anticlockwise direction. We just put this I alpha in the clockwise direction and say, rather than saying that these two, that this is equivalent to this, let us put the negative of that and then say that in terms of this torque, okay, in this pseudo torque, what is this pseudo torque? I alpha acting in the opposite direction, and in terms of this pseudo force M alpha, which is acting in the opposite direction, we can think of this body as if it's in some kind of equilibrium. And then what is one of the advantages of this? Okay, it's little bit artificial, but one of the advantages is that it will become very clear when Professor Shobhik Banerjee discusses about simple harmonic motion, that when we use D'Alembert's principle, all the virtual work principle and everything, those simple ideas which we had developed for statics, now can be applied to this equivalent dynamical system. So rather than saying that this is equivalent to this, we say this plus minus of this is equal to 0, okay? That is simply the D'Alembert's principle, okay? So we reverse this sign put here, reverse the sign of this put here, and this should be in some dynamical equilibrium, and that is nothing but the D'Alembert's principle. Now let us come back to what are the three body diagrams and the kinetic diagrams, okay? Let us take this simple example, okay? What do we have? We have this body around which a rope is tied, and we have applied some tension to this rope, okay? Previously, if you remember, we did not bother about angular acceleration, angular rotation at all. What we did is that we only bothered about acceleration in one direction, acceleration in the other perpendicular direction, done. What is the vector for acceleration? M times A is the force. But now, for an extended rigid body, we saw that there is this additional equation which comes into picture, okay, that mg is equal to I alpha, okay. So either we can use the equivalence, that this is equivalent to this, or we can say that negative of this, superpose over this, sum of this plus negative of this is equal to 0. So this is the D'Alembert principle. This is like our regular usage, okay, a standard use of dynamical equations. Now what are the various forces that act on this thing? One is the external force W, okay, one is the tension T. Now what do we do is that we isolate the body of interest, okay, clearly it is isolated, draw our axis system. We decide it is x, y, Cartesian polar, okay, the same technique what we had done for using Newton's laws. But now what do we need to do is that we also have the applied forces, which are the tensions, which are the support forces. We put everything together. But now, in addition to what we had done previously, there is this component of rotation that also comes into picture, which never came into came to the light when we discussed simple Newton's laws of motion for particles. Okay? And now what do? We draw what is called as a kinetic diagram, that all these forces, okay, and the effect of these forces, what? Sum of all the forces, sum of all the moments of these forces about point G, which is the centroid. Later on, we'll do one simple example where we can also do this when this point G is not a centroid, but it is some fixed point. But for the time being, let us say that if G is a centroid, then what happens? Okay? But now, what are the effects of these forces? Look here, what is the coordinate frame we had taken? X in the right, Y to the left, and this rotation in the anticlockwise direction. So what do? These moments, okay, in that sense, positive is this, positive is this, positive moment is in the anticlockwise direction, will lead to MAX for center of mass, MAY for center of mass, and I alpha in the anticlockwise direction for this. So that is the only component that gets added here, that this is this I alpha which comes here. That sum of all the forces is M alpha, sum of all the moments in the anticlockwise direction in this sense is equal to about point G is equal to I times alpha in the anticlockwise direction. Now let us take this another example. We have AC GB. we apply a force P, we need to find out what is the free body diagram and what is the kinetic force diagram. Now, note one thing, that this is a mechanism. If you apply some force P, there is nothing, okay, there is no reaction which can balance for this free body diagram, sum of moments about point C. So, clearly this will start to go into some kind of acceleration. What are the various reactions? Support reactions is Cx and Cy, it is a pin joint, this is the applied force, this is the weight. What is our coordinate axis? X and Y. This is taken to be in the anti-clockwise direction. So, this will produce an effect which is equal to what? I alpha in the anti-clockwise direction, Ax in this direction, Ay in the opposite direction. If you want to use D'Alembert's principle, okay, I am not going to use it in this class, okay, you will see that being used in Professor Banerjee's class tomorrow. What we can do? We will say that this is not equal to this, but put opposite of this, minus Ay, minus Ax, minus I alpha, and then say that this system is in dynamical equilibrium, that sum of all the forces acting on it is equal to 0. Okay, you can do that also, but what I am going to do in the rest of the class is this will produce, these kind of forces will produce a kinetic effect, which is acceleration in the x direction, m times acceleration in the y direction, I times alpha in the anti-clockwise direction. Now, let us come to this another problem. What we are given is a drum of 100 millimeter radius, okay, radius is given, attached to a disc of 200 millimeter radius, all these are given to us. Disc and a drum has a combined mass of 5 kg. Because of the symmetry, the mass will pass through, the effective mass will pass through the center of gravity, it is at G. The cord is attached as shown, the force of magnitude P is equal to 25 Newton is applied. We are given the coefficient of static and kinetic friction between the wheel and the ground, okay, mu s 0.25, asked to find out the free body diagram and the kinetic diagram for the wheel. So, what do? We find out that what are the given forces? Weight is a given force, P is an applied force, which is a given force. What are the reactive forces? Friction can be reactive force, normal reaction can be reactive force. How to take the direction will become clear when we solve a few problems, okay. P, W, friction is this, this is the normal reaction. Now, what is the effect, okay, all the dimensions are given to us, x and y is like this. So, the effect of these forces will be to create m times a in this direction for this mass, m times y in the vertical direction, okay, and I times alpha in the anti-clockwise direction, okay. So, we can keep going on and on. For the lateral problem also, what do we have? This was the problem we had briefly discussed, but in terms of statics. But suppose we are told that a ladder is now sliding down the wall, okay? This point A is coming down, point A is sliding to the left. So, what is the free body diagram and what is the kinetic diagram? Because this is sliding down, friction force will be up, sliding to the left, friction force will be to the right, reactions up, reactions here, the applied weight is the main force, W here. All these forces, what will be the effect? Will be to create MAX in the x direction, MAY in the y direction, I alpha, okay, in the clockwise direction. So, why am I emphasizing this so many times is essentially everything that we want to do, we have to just draw free body diagrams like this appropriately and we are essentially done, okay. Now, let us solve a simple problem. So, what we are given, okay, is this is the assembly, EA is inclined at an angle 30 degrees, FD is a link which is inclined at angle 30 degrees. To this, we have a mass A, B, C, D, which is pinned here at A, pinned here at D. So, mass of this can be neglected, very little mass, very little mass. This entire assembly is also attached to a cord HB in the vertical direction at point B. Now, note that if there is a cord also present and these two links are present, then whatever force is present, okay, this assembly can be kept in equilibrium by the reactions here. Why? Because these two reactions are parallel to each other, okay. But the third reaction is not parallel to the two reaction, neither do all these three reactions intersect at one point, and as a result, any force that is applied, moment balance, force balance can definitely be done on this. On the other hand, what is told in this problem is that this link is, this is broken, okay. That this wire is cut and we are asked to find out that immediately after the wire has been cut, the acceleration of the plate and the force in each link is what we want to find out. Now, first, let us think about this problem, okay, a little bit, okay, what may be the kinematics of this problem. How will this system deform? This is a parallelogram, distance AD cannot change, distance EF cannot change, FD is constant, EA is constant. So, kinematically, what can happen that this angle, okay, can decrease or increase, but this parallelogram will always remain a parallelogram. So, AD line, okay, it was vertical to begin with, it will always remain vertical, and as a result, AB will also remain horizontal, BC will remain vertical, this everything will just translate. But what will happen is that if you look at the center, you will see that this point A, just concentrate on point A, because it's a translational motion, each and every point will have the same motion, okay, including the center of mass, all of them are moving in the same way. So look at point A, how will point A move? Okay, when this link EA moves, this point A will move along the arc of a circle. So even center, okay, we will move along the arc of a circle, okay. In what direction? In this direction will be the radius of curvature, okay, the same as this direction. And what do we have? Okay, the radius of curvature will be 50 millimeters. So if you look at the center, what is happening? Okay, it is as if you just concentrate on the center, then center will try to move along the arc of a circle. But instantaneously, okay, at t is equal to 0, when this system is left from this position, okay, when you cut this, the system was initially at rest. So if you recall our pendulum problem, okay, that there was a problem which was present in the tutorial, what did we have? We had a bob, okay, which is tied here, but there is a horizontal string which is attached to the bob, and this is the weight. What we saw is that if you cut this string, that at that instant the velocity of this thing is equal to 0, and as a result the centripetal acceleration, okay, or the acceleration in the normal direction an, also is equal to v square by rho equal to 0. The only acceleration it has is in the tangential direction, okay, and what is that? That will be equal to w cos theta. Same logic is working here. Why? Because the center of mass, because the center of mass is only going to move in the arc of a circle. And what is the direction of the normal direction, what is the normal direction an is going to be along this, okay. Just think about this, the normal direction will be along this and the tangential direction will be perpendicular to this. So what we see from our logic is that instantaneously, because v is 0, v square by rho is equal to 0, so for the center of mass, okay, what is the acceleration? The acceleration will only have a component in a direction which is perpendicular to the direction of the link. So this is 30 degrees, so the direction of acceleration will only be in a direction perpendicular to the direction of the link. The second component of acceleration will be gone. Now that is great. So what we can do? We draw the free body diagram of this. This is the center. This is the force acting in the A from link A. It's a two force member. We are neglecting the mass of that. FDF is the force acting in this link DF. Now what do we have? This is the weight acting. This line is parallel to FAE. This line is perpendicular. From the logic that we had just discussed, because the system starts from rest, velocity of g is 0, so v square by r is 0, this an is 0, there is only at. But what is at now? These two forces are not contributing to that at all. So the only contribution coming, okay, of force coming in this direction is w cos 30. And so what we see is that sum of all forces in this t tangential direction is nothing but w cos 30 is equal to m times a. Okay, is the acceleration in this direction. From that we can find out that the acceleration of the center of mass is how much? Is 9.81 cos 30, okay, in this direction, inclined direction. So we know what is the effective acceleration of point G the moment this is released. Now after some motion happens, some velocity is accrued, then the acceleration will also have a normal component. But because we are starting from rest, center of mass will not have the normal acceleration at all. Now what do we want to find out? We also want to find out what are the forces in these links. So let us do, so we have used one equation of equilibrium, we are still left with two equations of equilibrium. One is for moment, moment and I alpha, and other is for another force. Now let us say we do find out that along this n direction, what is sum of all the forces? It is nothing but FAE plus FDF, and what is the another force acting in this direction? It is minus W sin 30. And sum of all those forces, okay, will be the acceleration in the normal direction. But we just saw that the acceleration in the normal direction is 0, so that is one equation that we get. Now let us take moment about point G of all these forces. And what do we know? That sum of moments of all the forces about point G, in this case convention taken to be in the anticlockwise direction, should be I times the alpha in the clockwise direction, okay. But note one thing, that what is happening is that this rod has no alpha, because we just saw that this is a curvilinear translation, that because of this linkage mechanism, okay, all points will just move translation like this. So the center of mass, there will be no rotation about it, and as a result, alpha is 0. So we take moment balance about point G, only moment component will come from this and this, but the weight will not add to the component. And so we can find out two equations, two unknowns, they can be solved to give us what is the force in this link AE and what is the force in this link DF. Okay, so we know this force, and instantaneously when this link is cut, cord is cut from the top, what is also the corresponding acceleration. Let us look at this problem. What do we have? That a cord is wrapped around a homogeneous disc of mass 15 kg. So the mass of this disc is 15 kg. This cord is pulled upwards, okay, it start from rest, okay, and just start pulling it upwards with a tension of 180 newtons. What we are asked to find out? We are asked to find out what is the acceleration, okay, of the center of the disc. Okay, the center of the disc is here G. What is the acceleration? What is the angular acceleration of the disc and the acceleration of the cord? Okay, so let us do that problem. What are the various forces? Various forces are tension, W. Now, what are the possible accelerations that it can have? X direction MAX, Y direction MAY, and I alpha, okay, or angular acceleration in the anticlockwise direction. Now, what are the forces acting in the X direction? Nothing. There are no forces acting in the horizontal direction. So, MAX will be equal to 0, no acceleration in the horizontal direction. But now, what are some of the forces in the Y direction? T minus W, that should be equal to mass times the acceleration in the vertical direction. So, T minus W is equal to MAY. T is given to us, W is also known to us. So, we know that instantaneously, AY will be equal to 2.19 meter per second square. Now, the last part is we want to find out what is the angular acceleration. What is the angular acceleration? Straight away, take torque about this center, take moment balance about moments of all the forces about this system. The sum of all the moments of this force and this force should be equal to I times alpha. If this is anticlockwise, this should also be anticlockwise. So the only force that can cause a moment can cause moment about point G is this tension T. So T times R. Okay, what is the direction? Direction is anticlockwise of this moment. So that should be equal to I alpha for a cylinder. Okay, Professor Shobhik Banerjee would have discussed that the moment of inertia about the center of mass or the centroid is half m r square. Okay, half m r square is for a disc or for a cylinder. Half m r square is the center of mass about this axis. So alpha will come out to be minus, okay, or in other words, that alpha is not acting in the clockwise direction, but it is acting in the anticlockwise direction. Now the second question for us is, what is the acceleration of the rope? Now the acceleration of the rope, again by the same logic which we had used previously, that this is an inextensible rope. So for every point here, okay, for the every point here, the tangential component of the acceleration, okay, will be the corresponding acceleration for the rope. Now point A here is common both to the both to this and to the rope. But from this disc, what is the angular acceleration? Okay, is equal to alpha, and alpha times 0.5 will be one component of the angular acceleration, alpha r, plus the angular acceleration, plus the total translational acceleration of g. The sum of these two essentially will be the total acceleration of this point A, which also, because of the inextensibility of the string, the total acceleration of this cord, which is nothing but the tangential component here, which is alpha times r plus, okay, A. Because this tangential component is nothing but the acceleration relative to the center of mass, but from a general frame point of view, there is also an additional acceleration for the center of mass, which is A. So, two add up here, okay, and that is the overall acceleration for the cord. Now, this is one really nice problem, okay. So, this is one very practical problem, okay. Now, what is given is this very nice problem, that a uniform sphere of mass m and radius r is projected on a rough horizontal surface with linear velocity v. That this cylinder has some velocity. Initially, it is not in contact with this surface, which has some kinetic friction, okay. Coefficient of kinetic friction is k. What we are doing is that we give it some velocity and let it fall onto the ground. Now, what happens is that because this has velocity v, initially all the points have the same velocity because we are not giving it rotation to begin with. But so when this point comes in contact with the ground, there is a finite slippage. This point on the uniform sphere. Now, note, this uniform sphere actually is a 3D object. But why are we taking this as a 2D object? Because if we look at the central plane of the sphere, cut it, this will look like a circular disc, and all the motions are happening in the plane of that center. Okay, that's why we are taking this as a planar motion. Now, what we are told is that that this is initial velocity because of which there will be a finite slippage between this point and a disc. And there is a kinetic coefficient of kinetic friction mu k between this and this. As a result, what will happen? There will be a retarding force. How much will that be equal to? That will be equal to normal reaction times mu k in the opposite direction. Now, physically, when we think about it, what happens? Think about it. This mu k force can cause a moment in the clockwise direction about point O, because of which this will start having angular velocity and angular acceleration in the clockwise direction. But what is happening? This force F, what does it do? This resisting force F, it also tries to apply a force in the opposite direction. So, if the velocity of the center of mass was in this direction, this is creating a force in the opposite direction. So, it tries to stop this sphere, tries to decelerate this sphere, the acceleration of the center of mass. Or if you just look at the center of mass, the speed of that will try to decrease. But what is happening is that because of this force, a torque is created or a moment is created about point G, as a result of which this sphere will tend to rotate about the center. So, what do? We draw the free body diagram. What are the applied forces? M, the W is the weight of the cylinder, N is the normal reaction, F is the force coming from the friction between this and the subsurface. And what we see is that this, using the laws, okay, using the balance laws, will be equal to MA only. Why? Because this sphere cannot lose contact with the ground, neither can it penetrate the ground. So, there is no acceleration for the center of mass in the y direction. This distance should always remain equal to r. And as a result, there is no acceleration in the y direction. So, N will become equal to W straight away. Now, what about sigma in Fx? We know that there is a finite slippage here. So, F in this direction will be equal to minus MA, because the direction of A is taken positive here, F is negative. So, minus F is equal to MA. But F, using friction law, because there is a slippage between this and this, is also equal to minus mu k mg. That will give us what is the acceleration. So, we see that the acceleration is minus mu kg in the opposite direction, or we have a deceleration of the magnitude mu k times g. Now, let us write a third equation. Moment of this force is about point g. Now, the only force that causes a moment on this body about point g is F times r. What is the direction? Direction is in the clockwise direction. And so, if you take the clockwise sign convention, this I alpha is also taken in the clockwise direction. So, F times r is the clockwise moment about the center, okay? We are taking it about the centroid, will be nothing, but for a sphere, what is the moment of inertia? It is 2 by 3 mr square, okay? We can directly take from the tables. 2 by 3 mr square is the moment of inertia of the sphere about an axis which is coming out of the plane and passing through the center of the sphere. So, mu k g r is equal to 2 mr square alpha. So, what do we get? We get that this alpha, okay, what is this alpha? The angular acceleration will be equal to 5 by 2 mu k g by r. Now, note one thing, that there is no particular relation right now between this A and alpha, because if there are pure rolling, then A and alpha will be related to each other. Okay, so these two are independent quantities now. A and alpha are two independent quantities. But now what we are asked to find out? We are asked to find out, determine the time t at which the sphere will start rolling without sliding, and the linear and angular velocities of the sphere at time when that happens. Now, what do? We write down the equation of equilibrium. For this one, there is a deceleration of how much? Minus mu kg. So, we write down that there is a constant deceleration. So, the velocity of the sphere as a function of time is v0 minus this deceleration times time t. Same equation can be written for omega, but for omega, this omega will keep increasing. How much will it increase by? Omega plus alpha t. What was alpha? We just found from the previous equation, okay, which is equal to 5 by 2 mu kg by r. Put that in here. And at the instant t1, okay, now how do we figure out that the sphere will stop sliding? It will stop sliding when at some instant the velocity of the center of mass will be equal to r times omega 1. Why? Because if v is equal to r omega, then relative to this to the center of mass, the velocity of this point C is equal to minus omega r in the opposite direction. But if v itself is omega r, then minus omega r plus omega r cancel out, and there is no relative slip between C and the ground. So, what will we see here is that just put v1 is equal to r omega 1, substitute everything, what will we find? We will find that after this time t, v will become equal to r omega, and substitute that in omega, we will correspondingly find out what is that corresponding omega, okay? And from that omega, we can find out v is equal to r omega, and what we find from here is that after what time and with what omega and with what velocity will this sphere stop sliding and come to rolling, okay, such that v omega is equal to r omega. And we can convince ourselves that when that happens, in this idealized behavior, okay, that when the contact is purely a point contact, when the sphere gets this uniform angular velocity, then all the frictional forces will cease to exist, and the sphere will now keep moving constantly at an omega, okay, and uniform velocity v of the center of mass. And that is the paradox, that for example, if a wheel is rolling with a constant speed, then in principle, this Coulomb's law will tell you that the wheel will never stop. But we see in reality that a wheel stops, and the reason being what is called as a rolling friction, that the point of contact is not perfectly a point, there is an extended area, like for example, tire deforming. And as a result, this final reaction, okay, doesn't, the contact is not a point contact, and the resultant reaction does not directly pass from this point of contact to A, but it has some moment, and that moment arm, okay, decides what is the rolling coefficient of friction. We are not going to discuss that. So what I want to do is that this problem, I want to briefly discuss in terms of conservation of angular momentum, okay. The way I will do is something like this. Now let us say, so I will show you that how different techniques can be used to solve a same problem. This one has velocity v bar, 0 to begin with. The angular momentum of this entire system about some point O, fixed point, okay, about a fixed point O is H O bar, which is simply M R bar cross V bar, okay, plus I omega bar. Okay. Now, if this sphere, okay, look at this sphere, what do we have? We have its initial angular momentum, okay, and what we had also seen is that dh0 by dt is equal to sum of all the moments, okay, about that point O, okay. And if this is equal to 0, what does that mean? That means that h0 bar is a constant vector. Now, what is the initial angular momentum for this system? Okay, let us say we will take this point O. Now, this point O need not be at the point of contact, it may be somewhere here along the ground. Let us say that this is point O here. Note, what are the various forces acting? W, N, friction. What do we know that about this point O, because of equilibrium in the y direction, sigma W minus N should be equal to 0, implies N is equal to W. Now, what is the moment by W and N about point O? Both of them cancel each other out. What is the moment of this force about point O? 0, because it passes through this line. So, what does that mean? That as far as point O is concerned, okay, the angular momentum of this body, okay, there is no torque acting on this about point O. So, the angular momentum of this object, okay, about point O should be conserved. Now, how do we use that? We note this is V0 to begin with, this is O. So, initial angular momentum H0 in what direction? In the clockwise direction, simply equal to m v 0 r, the final angular momentum, where v is equal to omega naught r, is how much? This is h 0 initial, h 0 final, will be equal to m v r plus I omega. But we want the point where v is equal to r omega. So, substitute it, what will we get? M v 0 r is equal to m v r plus I v by r, and solve for this, the velocity you will get will be exactly what we had obtained by solving this problem, okay, in a longer way. So, this is the way in which you can use principle of conservation of angular momentum for solving this problem. Now, second is, we talk about constrained motion, okay. Constrained motion, one of the examples is a non-centroidal rotation, okay. What is that example? Okay, the non-centroidal rotation, one simple example is when this sphere, for example, moves such that there is no slipping. then we know immediately that x is equal to r theta, a is equal to r alpha, and for rolling and no sliding, the friction force here should be less than or equal to mu s times n, a is equal to r alpha, rolling with sliding impending f is equal to mu s n, a is equal to r alpha, and rolling and sliding, in which case now it no longer remains constrained that a, or the acceleration of the center of mass, and r alpha, which is radius of the cylinder or radius of the sphere times the angular acceleration, are completely independent. Okay? So let us solve one problem like this. So what we have a sphere of weight w. It is released with no initial velocity and rolls without slipping on this incline. The incline ka angle is 30 degrees. So what we are asked to find out is determine the minimum value of coefficient of friction at this contact point, the velocity of g after the sphere has rolled 10 feet, okay, or 10 meter, okay. You can take this 10 feet is converted into 3 meters. So the velocity of the g of the center of mass after the sphere has rolled 3 meters, and the velocity of g or the center of mass if the sphere were to move 3 meters down a frictionless incline. Okay, means if this were completely frictionless, then what will be the velocity it will get? Okay, so these are the three parts of the problem. So let us look at the first problem, where we are asked to find out that for no slippage to happen between the point of contact C between the sphere and the surface, what is the minimum value of coefficient of friction? Now note one thing, okay, what can be the friction? Okay, let us say the sphere is trying to move down. Okay, when it tries to move down, what happens? Okay, it tends to roll about this point C, which is the instantaneous center of rotation at that point. Okay, because there is a torque by the weight caused about point C, so it will tend to rotate in this direction. And now what do we do? What we do is that it will have an angular acceleration about the centroid, and to create angular acceleration in this direction, okay, what is that? It is in the clockwise direction. The only way the friction can act will be in the upward direction. So only when friction acts in the upward direction, we can have a clockwise rotation and clockwise angular acceleration for this sphere. Now what do we know? We know that the sphere doesn't have any acceleration at its center of mass in the y direction. We also know that I alpha is related with this m alpha. Okay, this alpha and I are related with each other. Why? Because we know that there is no slippage. So A is equal to R times alpha. And so what do we do? First thing, okay, so this was one of the questions that was asked, is when there is a point of contact between the sphere, can we ever take a moment of this force about the point of contact and then write down the equation, the force and the moment balance equation? And the answer is this, that strictly speaking, okay, strictly speaking, the equations that we have written, that the rate of change of angular momentum with respect to a point is equal to sum of all the moments about that point acting on the body, that equation is true strictly only if the point O is a fixed point, it is not a moving point, or it is the center of gravity or the center of mass of the body. But what we think here is this, that we want to find out what is the instantaneous acceleration, okay, that in this configuration, what is the angular acceleration, and because there is no slippage, correspondingly, what is the linear acceleration of the center of mass of the sphere. So what we do is that this point C, okay, even though it keeps moving, the point of the contact keeps moving, what we do is this. We say that this point C is, say it is stationary on the ground. So at that instant, this point C is one fixed point on the ground. And so what do? We find out what is the moment of all these forces about this point. Okay? Now what is the relation that we get? Take sum of all the moments about this point, what should that be equal to? If sum of all the moments were taken about the center of mass, then what happens? This will be only equal to I times alpha. But note, because now we are not taking the moments about the center point, we are taking it about an arbitrary point. So what quantity will come? A quantity that will come will be m r cross a. Okay, and in this case r cross a will be what? A r in what direction? The same as the direction of moment, it will be in the clockwise direction. So m a r, okay, in the clockwise direction is the additional torque, is the additional component that we have to add here. Okay, and so just note one thing, that this sum of all the moments about a point is only equal to I alpha when this C is the center of mass. But when it is not the center of mass, there is an additional contribution, and the additional contribution comes from MA. What is MA? MA is mass times the acceleration of the center of mass. So in vectorial language, okay, in vectorial language, that contribution will be H O bar dot is equal to mass r bar with respect to O for the center of mass times v bar dot, which is A bar, and plus I alpha. Okay, this is for 2D plane motion, and what we see is that, and in this case all the components we are taking in the clockwise direction. So r cross v in the clockwise direction, this looks as just m a r, okay, in the clockwise direction. R cross A, okay, the direction will be in the clockwise sense. So moment w sin theta into r is the moment of this force weight, okay, acting on this free body diagram about point C, which is equal to m a r. So this term should not be forgotten because this is not the center of mass, plus I alpha. And you substitute in here, what do we have? This becomes m r square alpha plus 2 by phi m r square alpha. Substitute everything together and you will see that w sin theta r will be equal to this into alpha, or what you will see is that instantaneously at that point the acceleration in this configuration alpha is 5 g sin theta divided by 7 r, and correspondingly the linear acceleration of the center of mass is r times alpha, which just comes out to be this r goes away, 5 g sin 30 by 7, okay, which comes out to be 0.3.5 for after substituting the corresponding angle 30 degree here. Now note one thing, that we got alpha, we got A. We also realize is that there is a constant acceleration, okay, constant angular acceleration and constant linear acceleration. So if we want to now find out that how will the position and velocity of this evolve, then what do? We don't need to take this moment balance again and again, but we realize that at any point, if this were at any point, we will see that no matter what we do, the contribution will exactly be this. We can do whatever we want to, okay, but the contribution that comes for this alpha will always be the same, and alpha cannot change from one point to the other. So let us choose this alpha. So we know that for this cylinder, the alpha is given by this, A is given by this. Now let us do further force balance. Let us put our coordinate axis x in this direction, y in the perpendicular direction. What do we have? Sum of all the forces in the x direction should be equal to m times A in this direction. What are all the forces in the x direction? W sin theta minus f, it should be equal to ma. So we find out from this simple equation. See, we have not invoked it that mu is equal to f is equal to mu times n. We can directly find out. We can directly find out what is the value of f, and the value of f comes out to be 0.143 W for whatever parameters that we have here. Similarly, sum of all the forces in the y direction, there is no acceleration in the y direction. As a result, n minus w cos theta will be equal to 0, or n will be equal to w cos 30 degrees, and we find out what is the normal reaction. So now what do we have? We have that when this sphere is rolling without slipping, then the corresponding frictional force is this, and the corresponding normal reaction is this. So what do we want? That this ratio f divided by n should be less than the coefficient of static friction here, because there is we don't want to have any slippage here, and as a result the minimum coefficient of static friction will be nothing but this f divided by n. And we can find out that in this problem the static friction coefficient comes out to be 0.165. and note why we have used static friction coefficient is that even though the center of mass is nicely moving with some velocity, but at the point of contact there is no relative slip between C coming from the sphere and C coming from the surface. So at the point of contact the instantaneous velocity is zero, and so there is no slippage, and that's the reason why we are not using mu k and we are using mu s for this problem. Now we want to find out velocity after 3 meter of uniformly accelerated motion. Initial velocity is zero. The acceleration A we found out is what? From the previous slides, the acceleration is found out to be 3.5 meter per second square. We substitute in here, v square is equal to v naught square minus 2ax minus x naught, we already know. So we know that after moving a distance of 3 meters, the velocity that it will get will be 4.59 meters per second. The next part is, assuming no friction, calculate the linear acceleration and the corresponding velocity after 3 meters. Now if there is no friction, then what happens? Then there is no rotation at all, because it is only the friction which is causing this angular rotation, okay. On the other hand, if there is no friction, then this entire ball moves as if it is a particle of mass m without any rotation, and as a result sum of the forces in the x direction, okay, the only force is w sin theta. So acceleration in this direction is w by g is equal to W by G into A, W sin theta equal to W by G A, or what we find out is that the acceleration in this direction is simply acceleration due to gravity into sin 30, okay, sin 30 is half, so this becomes G by 2. And then as a result, we find out that the acceleration of this is nothing but just G sin 30, and from that we can easily find out what is the velocity after time, after it moves by distance x. And what we realize here is this, that the velocity here is lower when the rolling is allowed without slipping, the velocity is lower actually than correspondingly this. Now, how do we understand that? We understand that by noticing, okay, that if we use principle of conservation of energy for extended bodies, then this is the sphere, it moved down, okay, by a distance S is equal to 3 meters, this angle is given to us. In first case, what happens is that initially there is no velocity, here there is both velocity for the center of mass and there is also omega coming from angular rotation. Whereas in the other case, when there is no friction, it starts from here, it reaches here the same distance, but it has only velocity. Now, note one thing, that in both problems, the change in potential energy is the same. Initial kinetic energy is 0, so delta V should be my kinetic energy at the bottom here, and delta V should be equal to T1 prime at the bottom here. But note that because there is no angular rotation here, the kinetic energy at the bottom is simply half mass of the sphere into velocity of the center of mass. Whereas in this case, because there is also angular acceleration, that there is also angular velocity, the kinetic energy will be equal to half m vc square plus half I, what is I? This I is the moment of inertia about the center, omega square, where omega is equal to r vc. And because of this, there is some part which goes into this. As a result, this one, okay, this sphere, when the rolling is also allowed, will in general have a lower acceleration because it has two resistances. One resistance is coming from moment of inertia, other resistance is coming from the mass, whereas this one will have less resistance, okay, only resistance is coming from the mass, and some part of the kinetic energy in this case can go into the center of mass velocity, some part can go into the rotation into I, whereas here the entire potential energy get converted into half mv square, and as a result, okay, with this simple argument we can realize that the kinetic energy or the velocity, okay, in the first case will be lower than the velocity in the second case when there is no rotation. Now, we will solve this one last problem. Now, note here, it is a very nice problem. What is told to us is this, that knowing that the coefficient of static friction between the tires and the road is 0.8 for the automobile shown, determine the maximum possible acceleration on a level road assuming a rear wheel drive. Now, this was one of the discussions we had posted on Moodle, okay, that if something is a rear wheel drive, then there is a motor which is connected via the engine is connected to the wheels, okay, through the axle via the gearbox, okay. As a result, on this wheel there is an internal resistance because of which it cannot freely rotate, and there can be a friction that can act on the back wheel. Whereas in the front wheel, assuming that it's a perfect circle, okay, and the line of contact is only at one point tangential to this, we note that because there is no engine here, if the inner wheel is properly lubricated, then this is free to rotate, and as a result, it cannot take any horizontal force. Now, note here, what can happen? What kind of forces are possible? If this car is accelerating in the forward direction, okay, the frictional force has to act in the forward direction. This is a normal reaction on the back, this is normal reaction on the front. This G is the position of the center of mass of the vehicle. It is at a distance 1.5 from the back wheel, 1 meter from the front wheel, and it has a height of 0.25 meter from the bottom. Now, let us see, okay, what we are asked to find out, that when mu is equal to 80 degrees, what is the maximum acceleration that we can get for this? Now, how it decides the maximum acceleration? The maximum possible value of Fr decides the maximum acceleration. Why? Because the only force acting on the car in the forward direction is the force coming from the friction between the tires, okay, and that will lead to acceleration of this car. So, note, what is the effective kinetic diagram? That in principle, this car can have I alpha, rotation about center of mass, my, Ay and Max. But we don't want this car to have a rotation, okay, which means that the car is actually lifting up from the ground. Neither do we want to have an acceleration in the y direction. Why? This also means that the car is lifting from the ground. So what we want is that without lifting from the ground, what is the maximum acceleration that can be achieved when mu is equal to 0.8? So what do we say? That Ay is equal to 0, I alpha is equal to 0. So we write down equation for this car in the x direction, that sigma Fx is equal to Max. Okay, what is the only force in the x direction? Force R, friction, the frictional force coming on the rear wheel is equal to Max. Sum of all the forces in the y direction is equal to Ay. So Nr plus Nf minus Mg equal to 0. Why? Because we don't want this car to lift up, okay, and it is not possible for it to penetrate down. So this acceleration in the y direction has to be 0. Ultimately, we don't want this car to topple up, okay, because we don't want any alpha. So sum of all the forces above the center of mass should be equal to 0. So we solve this, okay, we get 3 equations. And now what we want to find out is what is the maximum possible force that can be exerted. So we say that Fr is equal to mu times Nr. Okay, we want to look at the limiting case. We now solve these 4 equations. So there are 4 unknowns, Fr, Nr, Nf. Okay, this is a normal reaction on the rear wheel, normal reaction on the front wheel, friction on the rear wheel, okay, and the acceleration of the car. So 4 equations, 4 unknowns, we can solve for them. And what do we get? That the acceleration of the car, okay, will be given by g divided by phi by 2 mu minus 0.5. And when mu is equal to 0.8, the maximum acceleration that the car can generate is equal to 3.74. Now, there is something pretty unusual about this equation. Naively, what we will think is this. We say, okay, if the car, okay, so there was one professor who had asked a question about the optimal value of the friction. I think that time I could not answer it properly. But what this expression tells us is, this expression tells us something quite funny. Our naive guess will be that if we keep on increasing the friction coefficient, this is great. Okay, our acceleration will keep increasing. Okay, but what we realize is that if we make mu equal to infinity, let us take an extreme case where mu is equal to infinity. Well, what happens? This Ax becomes negative. What does that mean? That a car is trying to move backward? This makes absolutely no sense. Then what is the mystery? The mystery here is that we have to realize that what is this frictional force doing? This frictional force, it is trying to create a moment about the center of gravity in what direction? In the anti-clockwise direction. And that moment, what tendency does that moment have? The tendency of that moment is to lift this reaction up. And if we solve this problem appropriately, what you will see is that in an hypothetical scenario, if the coefficient of friction is 3, then this normal reaction becomes equal to 0. So if we keep increasing the coefficient of friction, okay, make it like really, really large, and beyond a critical value, what will happen is that this car front wheel will lose contact with the ground and the car will tend to topple off. Okay, so as a result, okay, we cannot have a friction which is arbitrarily large. There has to be some optimum value of friction. Okay, if the friction value becomes very large, then the car will lose contact from the front wheel, okay, and will no longer be a stable drive. Okay, it will try to lift up. So that is the point I wanted to put forth from this problem. Okay, now with this, okay, just one last problem and then we can solve the tutorials. We have this assembly. We have an inner, we have a pulley of mass 6 kg and having a radius of gyration 200, okay, and connected to 2 blocks. Now, what is the radius of gyration? Okay, Professor Banerjee would have discussed that m times radius of gyration, suppose it is k, so mk square is the moment of inertia of this entire object about center C. Now, this problem becomes so nice and simple that the total sum of the moments acting about the center of mass, okay, is equal to I times alpha. We use this concept, this problem becomes amazingly good. Now, what we do here is this. Point C here, okay, point C here is what? Point C here is a fixed point. So, we use the concept here is that since this point C is a fixed point, let us look at this. All are connected to each other. So, what is the overall alpha for this system? Okay, we want to find that alpha out. Now, what we do is that, let us take point G. What is sum of all the moments about point G? Sum of all the moments about point G is, if we draw the free body diagram of this entire assembly removed from here. There is a weight acting here, 5 kg. There is a weight acting here, okay, 5 kg. So, what is sum of all the torques about this? Is 5 kg into RB in what direction? In the anti-clockwise direction. Okay, -2.5, okay, this 2.5 about center, what is the force it will exert, what is the torque it will exert? It is Ra multiplied by 2.5 in what direction? In the clockwise direction. So the total moment of all the external forces about point O, which is a fixed point, is simply equal to this difference of these forces, and we know that what is the unbalanced moment coming from the external forces about G, okay, which is the fixed point about which the pulley is free to rotate, okay, which comes out to be 1.227 Newton meter. Now the rotation, okay, we take it to, we take the counterclockwise, the rotation is now counterclockwise, okay, and mg in the counterclockwise counterclockwise direction is taken to be positive. So both rotation and mg in the counterclockwise direction, we now take it to be positive. What is the moment of inertia, okay, for this pulley is ik square. Now what do we know? We know that the acceleration of the block, okay, of this block A is what? Ra times alpha. Because why? They are connected to each other. So the tangential acceleration at this point will be essentially the acceleration of this block. Similarly, the tangential acceleration at this point will be the acceleration of block A. So we know that if alpha is one quantity, okay, which is an unknown, which is the angular rotation for this pulley about point C, then A, or the tangential acceleration at point A, will be Ra times alpha. At B, it will be Rb times alpha. So we know this is AA, acceleration of point A, this is acceleration of point B. Now what do we do? What we do is that we take moments about point G. What are the sum of moments about point G? We had discussed that in the last slide, that these are the only moment components that are acting, okay, we discussed here, on this free body diagram about point G. But what should that be equal to? That should be equal to, okay, what we had seen is I alpha, okay, about this G. What is I alpha? Plus what is happening now is that this is MAB into AB. So if you remember the term which we had discussed, that H bar dot about any point O is equal to M R A, okay, plus I alpha, okay. Everything has to be in the appropriate clockwise or in the anti-clockwise direction. So here, what is that contribution? The acceleration is acting in the downward direction. So MB into AB, okay, we are taking clockwise to be the positive one. So MB into AB into RB is that extra moment that we have to put, which is 1.5 minus MA into acceleration of A into this 0.25. Now what is that quantity? If you take that this is the acceleration of A, okay, what direction will be the, what will be the corresponding R cross A? It will be in the opposite direction. Now sum all these things together, sum of all the moments about point G will be equal to I alpha plus the extra components coming from the masses of these two. Solve this and we can find out what is the angular acceleration of this pulley. And once we know the angular acceleration, we can find out what is the acceleration of A and B. It is simply equal to R A times alpha for A and R B times alpha for B. Okay, so we are stopping our session here. If you have any questions, you need any clarifications, okay, I will be happy to answer now. So there is a question from center 1331. In the place of cylinder, if we take a block, can you please discuss the free body diagram and the kinetic diagram? Okay, so let us discuss that. If now having a cylinder, for example, okay, we have a block. Okay, so what are the forces acting? The forces are W sin theta, W cos theta, the normal reaction, and the friction force. Now, what is the difference between this and this? The difference is as follows. In this case, for example, the cylinder has no control, okay, it has no control, okay, over what should be the point of action of the reaction. So this has to be the point of action of the reaction, okay, it cannot help that. So as a result, F has to act here only in the tangential direction, normal reaction has to act at this point only in the vertical direction. And because of this unique capacity, what happens is that if, for example, for a cylinder, okay, if there is, if for example this W sin theta acts on the along the direction of the plane, then what happens is that this W sin theta can cause a torque about this point. And what is that torque? That can cause a torque in the in this direction, and there is no reaction to balance that torque. Whereas in a block, what happens is this, that suppose, okay, you have this W sin theta, we have this W cos theta. Now, what you will say is that, sorry, this is W cos theta. What you will say that the W cos theta is passing here, friction is passing here, okay. What if I take a moment balance about this point O? Well, there is nothing to balance the torque which is created by this W sin theta about this point, but that is not right. Why? Because this is an extended contact, okay, this is an extended contact, and as a result, the normal reaction that can come from the ground on this block, it can either act here, it can act here, or here, or here, or here. It has a complete freedom to change its direction, change its line of application. And in the case of a block, what will happen is that unless and until, for example, the toppling problem that we had discussed, that it's a huge block, and to this huge block we are applying some weight here, okay, what will happen is that the direction, the point of application of the normal reaction coming from the ground can always change and adjust itself in such a way that the moment that is W sin theta causes, okay, about this point can always be balanced by adjusting the normal reaction ka line of action. And that is a major difference between having a cylinder here and having a block here. Cylinder has no freedom to choose what will be the point where the reactions will act, whereas in a block, because the contact is extended, the resultant normal reaction, for example, can act here, 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 such that the moment which this W sin theta creates about this point will be appropriately balanced by that particular force. Okay, so that is the difference, okay, between a block and a cylinder. And as a result, for example, this is the simple reason why we use, for example, why wheels roll freely whereas a block does not roll. Why? Because a block, there is a resistance to rolling because of this fact. Now, from center number 1085, a question is asked that friction force is generally opposite to the motion, and in this problem, friction force has the same direction as the motion, and it was explained that the friction force is the one that accelerates the car. So, very nice question, and the idea will become apparent if you look at closely, okay, that this is the back wheel of the car. Suppose you have a rear wheel drive, okay, this is car, this is the front wheel of the car. Now, note that this back wheel, okay, what happens that this back wheel has an axle, axle is connected to the gearbox, okay, in layman's, in very simple language, and the gearbox, okay, is connected to the engine, okay, via flywheel and clutch assembly, okay. So, but those are the extra details. But what we have here is that, if we see that when we want to start the car, what do? When we turn the key on, okay, engage the clutch, okay, and give accelerator, the wheel starts to rotate, okay, like this. Now, what happens that when the wheel starts to rotate like this, it will tend to slip against the ground at this point. It will tend to slip in what direction? Tend to slip in this direction. So, the relative motion that the wheel tends to have against the ground will be in this direction, and it is that motion, okay, that the internal torque is being provided here. So, if I draw the free body diagram of the wheel, what do I get? This is the internal torque which is provided to the axle from the engine. This internal torque now becomes active. This is the weight, this is the normal reaction, and what happens is that the frictional force, how can it act? This is the internal torque M, okay, in this direction. So, about the center, sum of all the moments in the clockwise direction about the center O should be equal to I times, okay, what is I? Is the moment of inertia of this wheel times alpha, where is the, it is the angular acceleration about the center. Now, note one thing, that what are some of the moments? Some of the moments is the internal moment that is applied in this direction, okay, minus, okay, there has to be some force coming from the friction. Let us for the timing assume that the friction force is like this, okay, let us say it is this. Then what will happen is that the second force is F times R, where R is the radius of the wheel, and this is equal to I alpha. But note one thing is that this M is extremely large. And as a result, because this M is extremely large, you will see that this I alpha is a negligible quantity, and this quantity has to be approximately equal to 0, okay, to the first order, okay. It's a 0th level approximation, that this I is very small compared to the moments that are being exerted, and as a result, this F cannot have a positive direction, because then this cannot be nullified, and so to resist this moment, you will have M minus FR, which is approximately equal to 0. And what is this F? So F should have a direction in this direction, because otherwise the torque cannot be in the anticlockwise sense, and there is nothing to take care of the internal torque that the engine, okay, is exerting on the axle, and that has to be balanced only by the friction force. And so the friction force comes in this direction, and now that is a friction force, and that's the reason why now you have a car that is getting pushed forward, because the wheel is trying to do this. That is one component. Friction force acts on the wheel because of the free body diagram here, okay, which is drawn here. And as far as the complete car is concerned, the total force now acts in the forward direction, and that's the reason why the car accelerates. The same principle will also act, for example, you are trying to move a bike, okay. So I hope this is clear. Okay, in the last two questions sort, will there be any gyrocouple generated? Okay, there is no gyrocouple generated. Why? Because for a gyrocouple to be generated, we had discussed the other day, okay, this is beyond the syllabus that we are discussing now, but for a gyrocouple, what should happen is that if you have a wheel which is rotating in this direction, unless and until you apply a third torque, okay, in a perpendicular direction like this, the gyroscopic moment, okay, or a torque like this, because if you tend to rotate it like this, you have to provide a torque like this. So unless and until you apply this out of plane torques, okay, there cannot be any gyrocouple. But in this case, all the moments, okay, or in other words, all the torques, they all act in the plane. So there is no possibility of having a gyrocouple in this problem. Then the next question is, if slip is present, then only translatory effect will be considered. Okay, so you are right that, for example, if you say in this problem that these, for example, are not tied here. Okay, this is like a spool, that when this rotates, this is compulsorily will go up and this will compulsorily go down, and when this rotates in the clockwise direction, this will compulsorily go up and this will compulsorily move down. This is like, for example, a spool. But suppose this is like, for example, a belt. And when it is like a belt, for example, there may be no friction, okay, and in such a case like that, okay, that these two motions may be completely independent, that this may start slipping, okay, and this may rotate independently, and in that case, we have to draw the free body diagrams for this and this separately and analyze them separately. Even this problem can be attempted in that way. We can draw the free body diagram for B and A, take tensions, okay, find out what is the appropriate tension that is required, what is the appropriate tension required, then this TA minus TB, okay, will create a couple about point O, okay, not couple, a moment about point O, and that should be equal to I times alpha. So you can do that also, okay, but this problem becomes very simple. Why? That this is like a spool, okay, that this is tied at one end here, okay, so this rope goes here through the groove and it is tied here. So once you start rotating this, this has no recourse but to go in the upward direction. If you rotate it in the anticlockwise direction, it has no recourse but to come down, and same for point A. So that's why this problem is a bit simpler, and we can solve this as one complete problem, modify the mass of inertia, okay, by taking into account these two components, but you have to also add the components coming from the acceleration of A and acceleration of B, and then this problem can be very easily solved by noting that acceleration at A is equal to RA times A and acceleration of B is equal to RB times alpha, okay, not A, alpha. There is a question by center 1314. Can we consider the motion of a cylinder in a plane a constrained motion? Definitely we can, if there is no slippage, okay, the friction is enough such that there is no slippage between, or forget about friction, you know, that the conditions are such that the velocity of the center of mass V is equal to radius of the cylinder times omega, which is the rotational velocity of the cylinder. If that is the case, then what happens is that at the point of contact, okay, if I draw this here, this is V, this is omega. So at the point of contact C, what is the total velocity? Now relative to the center of mass, the velocity will be minus R omega in this direction, plus the velocity of center of mass will give us what is the absolute velocity of the cylinder at this point. Now if this is not equal to 0, then there is slippage, and omega and V can be independent, or A and alpha can be independent. But when there is no slippage, then what happens is that minus R omega plus V, there is no relative separation between these two, this is equal to 0, and then V becomes equal to R omega, then it becomes a constrained motion, in which case it is a one degree of freedom that is left, that either omega or V, and they are linked with each other, okay. So this is the reason why a cylinder, okay, moving on a flat surface, okay, without having slippage at the contact, okay, then this is one example, okay, where V is equal to R omega, and then this becomes a constraint problem that the alpha or the angular acceleration, omega, angular velocity, are not independent of the linear velocity and linear acceleration. They are related by V is equal to R omega, or acceleration is equal to R times alpha. So I hope these discussions are fine. Okay, so thanks for the bearing with me.